We are not hot. Mike, don't talk to me. You just... Thank you.
I'm living this moment because of you. I want to thank you and praise you too. And I'm living this moment because of you. And I want to thank you and praise you too. A sinner like me, oh, to tell this old world salvation's free. Oh, but there have been times I just didn't do right. But you watched over me, oh yes you did, both day and night. Your grace and mercy, Lord, your grace and mercy brought me through, and I'm living. And I just want to thank you, Jesus, and praise you too. Your grace, oh, your grace is less. Oh, yes, it did, Lord, it brought me through. I said justice demanded that I should die. Oh, but grace and mercy said, oh no, oh no, I've already paid the price. You see, I once was blind, but thank God, now I see. Grace
Good evening, everyone. Let's bow our heads for opening prayer at this time. Father God, we thank you for this opportunity to come together to celebrate the life of Sidney Freeman Sr. We thank you for his musical ministry that has impacted the lives of so many people. We are blessed beyond measure because you allowed Big Sid to be a part of our lives. We have all been impacted by his life and his musical ministry. You have blessed him with many gifts and talents to share with others. We ask that you will continue to comfort and strengthen his wife, his children, his extended family, his church families, and all those who loved him dearly. We thank you for all the memories that we can always hold in our hearts and in our minds. May we reflect on the good times as well as the challenges, because they're all a part of life. And we look forward to that day when we will be reunited again with Brother Sid, as well as all our other loved ones who have gone on before. It will be a great grand reunion in heaven. We pray for the anointing of the Holy Spirit on this memorial service. Be with every participant, and in the end, Father God, may your name be glorified and praised. We ask this and all other blessings in your son's most holy and magnificent name. Amen, amen, and amen. At this time, I have a tribute that I would like to share. It's in poetry. It's entitled A Tribute to Sidney Freeman Sr. When one thinks of Sidney Freeman Sr., the first thing that comes to mind is the fact that he was truly talented and musically inclined. He really loved to sing, enriching the lives of others, and he had lots of love for his Christian sisters and brothers. He was a sought-after musician who was in very high demand and would always be up for the occasion. While singing, he took command. He sung with many groups, and he also sung alone. It didn't matter how he came, for he will always set the right tone. He served in many capacities, president of the male chorus too, minister of music, and AYS leader, just to name a few. He loved life immensely and had a sense of humor second to none. Whenever you spend time with Big Sid, you will always have lots of fun. He was a father to the fatherless, a leader among men, intelligent and genuine, one in which you could depend. He had finesse and style, and often came to impress, carrying himself with dignity, and also had finesse. He had an infectious smile and a big wide grin. Before he even spoke, you were already taken in. He was a supportive, loving father, a loving husband and son too, a friend to many people, for he had no problems helping you. He loved and admired his children, wanting for them only the best, preparing them for life so they could pass the test. They brought so much purpose and joy to his life. Little Sid, his firstborn, Marcus, his twin, and Cassie, his sugar and spice. Cassie was the most beautiful girl in his eyes. He showered her with love, making her feel special as she was his gift from God above. His name will go down in the Music Hall of Fame for songs like My Soul's Been Anchored, for he loved to magnify the Lord's name. He also sung Stand, and This Is Your Night, bringing hope to many, for he understood their plight. Though sickness came upon him, and he had to rest for a while, he will always be remembered for his unique singing style. Rest in peace, Big Sid. We will miss you, that's for sure. When you get to heaven, your voice will be enhanced even more. So for now, we'll say see you soon. Never farewell or goodbye, for we'll see you again in that sweet by and by. You fought a good fight. You finished your race. No more toiling or sickness as you wait to see the Lord's face. So rest now and be at ease, for the next face you will see is that of your Lord and Savior saying, well done, a good job indeed. Sorrowly submitted, written by myself on behalf of your Mount Olivet SDA Church family, AEC conference and constituents, your family, extended family, and friends. God bless you. We love you. Rest in peace.
Good evening, family. As we prepare to hear from the Lord through his word, I encourage you to stay uplifted. Don't allow the pain that you experience to pilfer and pillage your praise. Though there is sadness, don't allow that sadness to silence the shout unto the Lord that you have, and allow God's grace to overwhelm you with his presence as he seeks to comfort you in this time. I will read for you in your hearing 1 Thessalonians 4, verses 16 and 17, followed by Revelation 21, verses 2 and 4. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel, with the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. After that, we who are still alive and are left will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever. Revelation 21, 2 and 4. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people. And God himself shall be with them and be their God. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there will be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. May God comfort you with his word both today and in the days to come.
I met Sidney Freeman at Franconia College in 1977. When I found out that he had passed and that I lost one of my best friends, all I could think about was his critical thinking, his brilliant mind, a leader activist, and a 20th century race man who taught me so much and supported my triumphs and challenges. I love Sidney's mind. He was brilliant, and our conversations helped each of us to grow. His willingness to share his unfiltered insights as a Black man in America with me has been an invaluable gift. You see, Sidney understood before I did what my calling was and why God put me on earth. And that is to work on racial justice issues. And Sidney has been my thought partner and accountability partner for over four decades, resulting in me being a better leader and being better able to serve my community. I have four decades of wonderful memories that I can't fit into a two-minute clip, but I am just going to share this picture of the island of Bermuda, because Sidney and I did lots of great first together. We traveled to Bermuda for the first time together. We went to a college that went bankrupt together. We survived the 20th century into the 21st century. And he's been my friend and mentor. And I love him and I'll miss him. And the four decades of memories include wonderful events, Legal Seafoods, J.P. Licks, bringing Sidney Jr. to a national conference with the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, and visiting me in June to let me know how he was doing. I am so sad that I won't have those times in the future, but I'm grateful for the moments that he shared with me. And Cassandra, Marcus, and Sidney Jr., I know what a source of pride and how grateful he was to have parented you. You are his legacy, and you will move forward his values and his brilliance in the future. And I am so grateful to have been a part of his life. Rest in power, my dear friend, Sidney Freeman.
Good evening, everyone. First, I want to thank God for opportunity to say some awesome things about Sid. I thank the children for asking me to give a few words, and that's what they're going to be. They're going to be a few. I thank God that he allowed us to be a part of Sid's life. I thank God for his wife, for his Connecticut family, for his immediate family, and especially for his children. I thank God for allowing me to experience what it was like to be married to a funny guy, to a serious guy, to someone who loved the Lord and wanted to serve him. I'm thankful that through crisis, God brought our family back together as a unit in the cause for our daughter, Cassie, coming through her crisis. And through that, we were able to talk, we were able to mend fences, we were able to pray together, laugh together, cry together. And I'm thankful. I'm so thankful. And the Holy Spirit prompted me a few weeks ago, maybe about 4 or 5 weeks ago, to call Sid. And I asked him, are you happy? And he said, I'm very happy. And I told him I wanted him to be happy because everyone deserves to have some happiness. And I thanked him for being the father of my children. And through that, he said he was sorry that he couldn't be the husband that I needed him to be. And it was okay because God's got me. But I believe that everyone should have some happiness in their life. I'm happy in me. I'm happy in God alone, and it's okay. And right now, I'm thankful for my strong children. I'm thankful for God bringing Cassie from the darkness into this marvelous light that he has brought her into. And all our questions have been answered. We know that God kept him. And one of these days, we're going to sit at the welcome table, feast on milk and honey, tell how we made it over, walk and talk with Jesus, sing and never get tired. One of these days, it was worth it all. To God be the glory, great things he has done. Thank you all for the part that you played in the Freeman family's life. We love you all. Be blessed. Thank you.
a silent war that's raging deep within me. My lower nature fights to dominate. My spirit man is poised and locked in battle. With the carnal side of me, I've grown to hate. The trumpet of my prayer plays toward heaven. A voice of desperation in my cry. Lord, strengthen me that I might not yield myself to sin, but keep your righteous banner lifted high. So, Lord, I hunger for holiness, and I trust for that righteousness that's yours, that my mind would be cleansed and my spirit renewed, and this temple that you dwell in, it would be pure. The tempter stalks about me like a lion, and he's searching for that slightest scent of blood. For when the skin of my resistance is broken, he moves in swiftly beneath the cup. O Lord of creation, hear your servant. You understand the weaknesses of man, so I'm counting myself crucified with Jesus, alive to Christ and dead indeed to sin. So Lord, I hunger for holiness, and I'm trusting for that righteousness that's yours, that my mind would be cleansed and my spirit renewed, and this temple that you dwell in, yes, this temple that you dwell in. So Lord, I hunger for holiness, and I'm trusting for that righteousness that's yours, that my mind will be cleansed and my spirit renewed, and this temple that you dwell in, that it would be pure. For I hunger, Lord, I hunger for holiness. your holy name.
There's two things I know for sure. She was sent from heaven, and she's daddy's little girl. As I drop to my knees by her bed at night, she talks to Jesus as I close my eyes. And I thank God for all of the joys in my life. Oh, but most of all, for butterfly kisses at bedtime prayer, sticky little white flowers all up in her hair. Walk beside the pony, daddy, is my first ride. Does the cake look funny, daddy? You know that I tried. Oh, with all that I've done wrong, I must have done something right to have her love in the morning and butterfly kisses at night. Sweet 16 today, she's looking like a mom a little more every day. One part woman, other part girl, to perfume and makeup from ribbons and curls, just trying her wings out in a great big old world. But I remember butterfly kisses at bedtime prayer, sticky little white flowers all up in her hair. You know how much I love you, daddy, but if you don't mind, I'm only gonna kiss you, daddy, on the cheek this time. Oh, with all that I've done wrong, I must have done something right to have her love every morning, butterfly kisses at night. All the precious time, like the wind, the years, they go by. She's my precious butterfly, spread your wings and fly. She'll change her name today. She'll make a promise, and I'll give her away. Standing in the bride room, just staring at her, she asks me what I'm thinking, and I tell her I'm not sure. I just feel like I'm losing my baby girl. Then she leans over, gave me butterfly kisses with her mama there, sticking little white flowers all up in her hair. Walk me down the aisle, daddy, it's just about time. Does my wedding gown look pretty, daddy? Daddy, don't cry. Oh, with all that I've done wrong, I must have done something right to have her love every morning and butterfly kisses. I couldn't ask God for more. Man, this is what love is. I know I've got to let her go, but I...
Good evening, everyone. The obituary. Sidney Snyder Freeman Sr. of New Haven, Connecticut, departed this mortal life on August 26, 2021. He was born to Pauline Dodds Freeman and James Freeman on July 25, 1957. Sidney attended New Haven Public Schools and continued his love for learning at Franconia College in New Hampshire. After college, Sidney moved to New Jersey where he married Cassandra Lewis Freeman. They had and raised three wonderful children, Sidney Jr., Marcus, and Cassie. He was employed for many years with UPS, Bayada, a home health care agency, Gold Star, a snack and beverage vending machine company, and the Better House, a group home for troubled teens. While in New Jersey, he became a member of Mount Olivet Seventh-day Adventist Church. As an active member in the church for almost 30 years, he led out in various capacities. He played on the Mount Olivet's basketball and softball teams, served as Minister of Music, Adventist Youth Society leader, singer in the male chorus, and school board chair. Sidney was loved by various churches in the Allegheny Conference of Seventh-day Adventists, and one of his greatest joys was to encourage and to support young people, particularly those who sang. While he was a gift to his Mount Olivet Seventh-day Adventist Church, he also had a ministry that went beyond these four walls, reaching out to other SDA churches as well. Additionally, though a committed Adventist, he developed a music ministry that blessed the hearts of those beyond his denomination. He was a musical trailblazer throughout the region, whose musical range spanned various genres, from Black Southern gospel to white gospel, from contemporary gospel to sweet, soulful music. He loved the city of Camden, New Jersey, and had a passion to see it thrive. One of the ways that he did that was by partnering with various community organizations, such as the Fair Share Housing Development, Inc., and Northgate Park, Inc., where he served as host at the annual summer concert at Northgate Park. He often hosted programs at local senior centers and nursing homes in an effort to lift the spirits of the residents. But arguably, his greatest contribution to the body of Christ and the broader community was his over 30 years of music ministry. He was blessed to sing all over the East Coast of the United States, ministering in church services, camp meetings, weddings, and other special occasions. Sidney even recorded a solo gospel album with award-winning producer Adrian T. Wesney. He loved to minister with his friends such as Wendell O'Brien and LaVon Tatum. He also was most proud of leading and developing the Freeman Family Singers, which included his former wife and children. They went on to open for well-known artists such as Ty Tribbett and the Greater Anointing Choir, and also singing at the General Conference of Seventh-day Adventists headquarters in Silver Springs, Maryland. Sidney was an intellectual who pushed people to think deeply about the church, equity, and racial justice. He was a bridge builder and unifier who sought ways to bring diverse people together. He was particularly proud of being a part of visioning and leading international days at the Mount Olivet Seventh-day Adventist Church,
where they would host people of different racial and ethnic backgrounds to worship and praise together. Sidney returned to his hometown of New Haven, Connecticut in 2016. He enjoyed rekindling childhood friendships and reminiscing on the past times spent there in New Haven. And in 2017, he married the former Rosalind Minder. Sidney was also a streetball basketball legend in New Haven, known for his sweet and smooth skills on the court. Besides singing, his favorite pastimes were watching basketball, football, and live bands. Sidney loved his family dearly and enjoyed spending time listening to their dreams and passions. He encouraged all those around him, even when he wasn't 100%. His calming voice, soothing notes, and smooth demeanor will truly be missed. Sidney leaves to cherish his memory, his beloved wife, Rosalind Freeman, son, Sidney Jr., Linda, son, Marcus, daughter, Cassie, stepdaughter, Brittany Odom, former wife, Cassandra, brothers, Eddie Freeman and Daniel Freeman, and a host of relatives and friends.
All right, good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for being with us. I'll ask Cassie to start first, and then Marcus, and then I'll round this out.
Okay, good evening, everyone. And thinking about Dad, I can appreciate so many things that he's contributed to my life specifically. He loved me, and he yearned for a relationship with me that was real, that was special. And I can remember his active efforts in that. He would always plan different events that we could get together and do, where I learned, where it fostered my likes and my dislikes. He always wanted me to have, to never be stuck in a box. He gave me the mindset of and love for cultural diversity. He challenged my mind in so many different ways that made me think, and that made me truly have a mind of my own in many, many different ways. And I love him forever for it. He loved music, and because of that, all of us love music. In a very specific way, either personally or the sound of others. We love music, and he was never put in a box in that category as well, as was said in the thoughts. And I just love, even in the time between the last memorial and this one, I was able to reflect on Dad and the different things I see in myself that were directly from his lifestyle and who he was, which I appreciate so much. In the closing scenes of his life, I was the closest to him. Then in my entire life, I called him almost weekly or daily. And there were moments that I know that he always yearned for throughout my whole life. And I know for a fact that those moments were special to him, because they were very special to me as well. And we finally had the relationship that I think he always wanted. And I truly am thankful for the time that God gave me with him, because I can really see how much he loved me. With me or in the moments he wasn't around me, even when others talk about him, I see how much he truly loved me. And he really is one of a kind. And I'm so thankful that I had the privilege of having him as my father. And I can't wait to see him again when God parts the clouds and comes and gets his children. I just got to make sure that I'm ready and I'm right. And so that's my goal in the legacy of him, I guess. Just make sure I'm ready to see God and see him as well. Thank you.
First off, I want to thank everybody for the love, the thoughts, the prayers, the phone calls, and all experiences that were given in regard to reaching out to the family and showing love. And we want to 100%, 1,000% just want to thank everybody for their love. Whether we were able to respond back or if you did hear from us, please know that regardless of the response, that we truly felt it. It's been an outpour unlike any other that I know I've experienced. So I want to thank everybody for that. And a real quick reflection on my father, three things come to mind. So Dad loved knowledge. So much so, I remember at one point there was a student at my school when I was in elementary that I used to try to make fun of because I thought he was a nerd. And when Dad found out, he was like, "Okay, well we're gonna read the dictionary." And so there was so many opportunities and elements. I think Cindy remembers that where he would love the opportunity to make sure to educate and give you the resources to educate yourself. And that took me a long way, even though, you know, it felt like punishment at the time. You know, it resonated and I use it to this day. Another thing that pops in my mind is that Dad was a sharer. And the thing about Dad was, especially when it came to food, he would always want to share his food and try your food. And I wasn't really trying to share my food, but he would always try to share his, like, come on, man, try this. And it's funny because no matter what, up to this day, I still will not try coleslaw. But he was a sharer, and he gave without a second thought. And then ultimately, you know, he loved us. And that is without a doubt. And you know, even as I identify as a grown man, you know, Dad would still try to kiss me. And that was always something that, you know, he would, whether or not, I resisted or not, he would always just tell me, like, he was like, "You're always going to be mine. You know, you're always my child. So I don't care how old you get, you know, I'm gonna kiss on my kids." And so in summary, I am filled with love for the man that not only raised me, but loved me and instilled in me all the essence of who I am today. And, you know, I've been telling everybody in conversations that I've had over this last week or so is that there's really only one thing that we can hope for when death comes. And that is that the person that we love knows that we love them, and that we know that, you know, they loved us. And without a shadow of a doubt, I know that Dad and all of us mutually shared that. And so I am continuously, you know, day by day, just thanking God out of all the people that he could have chosen to be his children, he chose me. And I'm forever honored. I forever feel as I said before, a trophy to represent and continue the legacy of my father, Sidney Freeman Sr. And I thank everybody.
So Marcus did a wonderful job of of thanking others. But I would like to thank the Ma'alavit Seventh-day Adventist Church for their outpouring of love, particularly the communications department in helping to facilitate this program on tonight. And also want to thank Pastor Best for his leadership at the church and enabling this service to happen. I want to thank all of those who text and called and helped with bring this program together. I thank all the participants for their willingness to be a part of the program. I would be remiss without acknowledging my mom, Cassandra Freeman, and also my stepmom, Miss Roz Freeman. And we're thankful for both of them, their role in our lives and their role in Daddy's life. And we wanted to make sure that they both were acknowledged for their love for my dad. I will end with this, that I would ask you to please continue to keep us in your prayers, Marcus, Cassie, and I. I often would hear when people would lose family members, that initially when it happens, there are a lot of people that show love and support, and then after a while it wanes. But I would just ask that you continue to pray for us and reach out to us. And we just want to say that we love you and thank you and appreciate you for taking the time out to celebrate this great man, Sidney Freeman Sr. Thank you.
Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. In the light of his glory and grace.
Good evening, everybody. It is such a high honor and a privilege for me to participate in and to be a part of this great celebration service for the life of whom I considered my younger brother. 32 years ago, I met Sydney, and the impact of his life has been tremendous upon me and my family. And this evening, just want to spend a little time to depict the character of such a man of God. I'm not going to do this all by myself this evening, and so I'm going to ask my daughter, Keo, whom he knew when she was 11 years old, to help me celebrate Sydney's life. So, your turn, Keo.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, what Thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul. And Lord, haste the day when my faith shall be sight. The clouds be rolled back as a the trump shall resound, and the Lord shall descend. Even so, it is well with my soul. It is well, oh, with my soul. It is
Father, we thank you for the life that our brother lived. And Lord, we know that it is well with his soul. And we pray, O God, that it shall be well with all of our souls as we prepare for heaven together. We ask in Jesus' name, amen. As I thought about my younger brother this evening, the text of scripture came to mind, found in the book of John, John chapter 11, verses 25 and 26. And the scripture reads, and Jesus says, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And he that liveth and abideth in me shall never die. Believest thou this? We've got to believe the words of Jesus. And I believe that these words can be applied to Sydney in a special way, because the Bible says, he that believeth in me, though ye were dead, yet shall ye live. And I believe that Sydney will live again. And he that liveth refers to the rest of us. And believeth in me shall never die. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 17 to 21 talks about the new life in Christ. It says, if any man be in Christ, he is a man, a woman, boy, or girl. He or she is a new creature. All things are passed away. Behold, all things have become new. God is saying to everyone this evening, we need to be born again. And once we're born again, we can take it to the bank that if we believe in Jesus and should die in this world, should go to sleep, we shall rise again to see Jesus. And those of us who remain and alive, he says, if you believe in me and you're living right now, you shall never die. Someone has written a book, a gentleman by the name of Ruthven J. Roy. He wrote a book called Born Again, How to Maximize Your New Life in Christ. Believers live this life of up and down, sometimes up, sometimes down, sometimes level with the ground. We don't need to live that kind of life anymore once we're born again. We can live a victorious, consistent life in Jesus Christ because the life of Jesus Christ has now become our life. Jesus had no failures in his life. Jesus was not discouraged in his life. He was not depressed. We suffer. So many Christians are suffering from depression and guilt and worry and fear. We don't need to fear and worry anymore if we believe in Jesus Christ. The Bible says if a man, woman, boy, or girl is in Christ, he or she is a new creature. And I believe that new creatures in Christ, we are spirit beings. Just as Jesus is human and divine, we become human and divine because we're born again. Born, the Spirit is our Father and the Word is our Mother. And we have been given a new birth. And with this new birth, we can live forever. We shall never die because God cannot die. So I want to leave that with us this evening. Let us believe in Jesus. And as Brother Sid is now resting in him, he shall live again. We shall see him soon and very soon. As you look at the world today and all that's happening around us, we know it's not going to be long. Soon we'll be leaving here. Won't be long, we'll be going home soon, and very soon we are going to see the King. And the Bible says, Jesus Christ shall burst the clouds of glory soon and soon and very soon. One of these days, he said that the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead, Brother Sid, in Christ shall rise first. And then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together to meet them in the air, to meet them with Jesus Christ in the clouds in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. So family, let not your hearts be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me, says Jesus. In my Father's house are many mansions. If you were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And he went. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again, and you will come again to receive you unto myself, so that where I am, there ye may be also. So comfort one another with this saying, the Bible says. So brothers and sisters, ladies and gentlemen, family, among the Olivet family, my family, Sid and Marcus and Cassie and Sandra, Cassandra and Ross and Larry and all the brothers that Sydney had, George Vanake, all the people, the members of his family at Mount Olivet and elsewhere. Let us look forward to that soon coming when we shall see your brother one more time in his glorified body. This mortal shall put on immortality, and this corruptible shall put on incorruption, and we shall be changed in a moment, in the twinkle of an eye. The trumpet shall sound, and he shall rise up, and we shall join him soon and very soon. So comfort one another with these saying. I am the resurrection of life, says Jesus. He is the great I am. Water for the thirsty, food for the hungry, clothing for the naked, mother for the motherless, father of the fatherless, the great I am that I am. Jesus Christ is everything we need. All we've got to do is look to Jesus, and it shall be all right. Thank you, Lord, for hearing and answering our prayer, O Father, to keep us faithful until you come again. We ask in Jesus' name that all God's children say amen and amen and amen.
Though the storm keep on raging in my life, and sometimes it's hard to tell the night from day, still that hope that lies within, it reassures. As I keep my eyes upon the distant shore, I know he'll lead me safely to that blessed place he has prepared. But if the storms don't cease. And if the winds keep on blowing, my life, my soul has been anchored in the Lord. Oh, the storm on raging in my life, and sometimes church is hard to tell the night from day. Still that hope that lies within reassures as I keep my upon the distant shore, I know he'll lead me safely to that blessed place he has prepared. But if the storms don't cease, in my life,
in this whole life, you're gonna be tossed by the waves and the currents that seem so fierce. But listen, you know what I found out in the Word of God? Sydney has an anchor. It keeps me steadfast in an unmovable. Despite whatever the time. But if the storms don't cease, and just in case the wind keeps on blowing. My song's been a gift in the Lord, in the Lord. Yes, it's in the Lord. My song's been a gift in the Lord. The breaker may dash, I shall not sway, because he holds me fast. So come the day, Lord in the sky, church is alright, because Jesus and I. Tell me, your soul been angered? Have your soul been angered? Have your soul been angered? Have your soul been angered? The Lord.